will be rather informal. It will not be an elaborate introduction. In fact, actually, what I wanted to say is that this is the first time in almost 50 years that I have known her that I've had a chance to introduce her. So it's a special treat for me. Violette, when I first met her, a young mother, her three-year-old daughter, Bahir, and her husband, Ali, were preparing to pioneer in Africa. And as you know, they went to Uganda in 1951 as pioneers, along with Violette's parents, Mr. and Mrs. Barani. And it was actually as they arrived, they left Iran, and as they arrived in London and they were waiting for their passport, their visa to go to East Africa, that my husband and I, we were just newly married, we met them in London. And that was the first time that I met Violette. It was the first time I met my niece's parents as well. And so on that occasion, she was a very young woman, and I'm a little younger than she is, but I looked up to her because she was a mother of a three-year-old child. She was a person who was about to launch into a life of pioneering. I don't think that she, and certainly not I, realized what was to lie ahead in her life. 1951, when she landed in the continent of Africa, a young mother, she was to devote several years to teaching work there. Of course, primarily as a wife and mother, but independently on her own, also doing travel teaching. And then you know the story of how her husband Ali was elected to the International Baha'i Council in 1960, I think it was, or 61. And so 10 years after she arrived in Africa, she found herself in Haifa while Ali was serving on the International Baha'i Council. And then, as you know, 2 years later, by 1963, when the first election was held for the first Universal House of Justice, lo and behold, Ali was elected to that body. And so Violette now found herself in Haifa serving the faith there. And that really was another tale. Tonight are going to be recollections that she will share with you. Violette has traveled with Hand of the Cause, Amato Baharu Rukhano, practically every place in the world. In fact, I asked her, is there any place in the world you haven't visited? And you know, she said there was one place. And I don't know what's the matter with them, why they don't call. Alaska. Alaska is the only place that she could think of off the top of her head that she had not traveled with Khanum. And as you know, those of you who have seen Khanum in her various visits around the world, and you see Violette sitting next to her or near her, it's Khanum who is telling the stories. So tonight, Khanum is not here. We have Violette, who is going to share recollections of whatever she wants to share. And you have a treat. She's a little nervous about doing this, but that's because she hasn't had a lot of opportunity to be on stage, you know, in front of the microphone telling the stories herself. But she, you know, she's written books about the travels of Rabbi Khanum.
served a lot over these years. So this is a special occasion tonight that we have her all to ourselves, and she isn't hiding behind anybody else. She's going to be right here. Uganda was a virgin territory. No Baha'i had been in it before. And for us from Iran, it was something unbelievable. When we were leaving Tehran and our friends knew we were going to Africa, they thought we were mad. And we knew nothing about where we were going. Incidentally, Uganda is so beautiful. It's one of the most beautiful countries you can find, not only in Africa, but in many places of the world. For many months, the first 6 months of our sojourn in Uganda, it was very hard. First of all, half of it, we had to fight to get our residency in that country. We were the first Iranian family to go to Uganda, and government officials didn't know where to place us. In those days, everybody had a pigeonhole. You were placed either as Asian, which meant the Indians, or you were Africans, which meant the black African of the continent, or you were European, who came from wherever, the white man. And we didn't fit into any of these pigeonholes. So it took almost 3 months before they gave us a permit to reside in Uganda. And the next 3 months, we were trying to see how to make headways, how to find people, how to introduce the faith. My husband, who is even till now a great fan of football, he started going to the football matches, and there he would make friends. In the early January 1952, we had a nucleus of, apart from our family, three African Baha'is. We had very wonderful weekly meetings that many people came into, but it was not easy. People were not accepting faith easily. It was very strange. They had never heard of it. It was had nothing to do with the churches that they were used to. So in 1952, at the end of 51, beginning of 52, something wonderful happened. Shoghi Effendi lifted the ban that he had placed for 10 years on pilgrimage. These were the 10 years during the Second World War, all the internal wars of Palestine and the War of Independence. Eventually, the State of Israel was formed, and then the Beloved Guardian lifted this ban, and the Baha'is were permitted to go on pilgrimage. My parents were one of the amongst the first groups of pilgrims who went to visit the Holy Land. So we had every Sunday a gathering in our house, teaching gathering, and we asked my parents that when they reach Haifa, that they would ask the Beloved Guardian on the first Sunday that they are there, that when he goes to the shrine of the Baal with the pilgrims, if he would remember the friends in Uganda and direct his prayers towards Uganda so that maybe our teaching meeting that day will bear some fruit. We had a meeting on that Sunday with over 25 people there, all very wonderful young men. One of them, a very shy young man that we had seen for 2-3 weeks previously. He never asked any questions, he never made any comment, but he was there. He was a young man who came from humble origin, and he had a lot of problems, and he was very intelligent. So that Sunday, he was also amongst all the people who were there. We were terribly excited. We saw the Shoghi Effendi crying, praying in the shrine for us. Surely we are going to have a number of new Baha'is to enter the faith. The meeting went on as usual, 2-3 hours of prayers, questions, answers, discussions. Everybody had tea and cake, and they got up and they left, and nothing happened. I cannot tell you how crestfallen we were. We didn't know what happened. We didn't want to talk about it. But we knew, each one of us thought, well, did the Beloved Guardian pray for this meeting? What happened? We just sat there in our thoughts, and about half an hour later, there was a knock at the door. And when we opened the door, this shy young man was standing behind the door. And he apologized profusely. He said, you know, I had a question, but I was too shy to ask it in front of the people. Do you mind if I come and ask my question? We all jumped and he said, come in, please. He came in and his question was, how one becomes a Baha'i? So he accepted the case. This was Enoch Olinga. And he is the one I want to speak about tonight. He has been, for some reason, very much in my heart and in my soul these past 2 weeks. I have traveled all over the world, and you can't believe how many Enoch Olingas I have seen in different stages of growth. Some of them are now grown up, men, and sometimes even women, whom I hope will follow in the footsteps of this wonderful man. As I said, when he became a Baha'i, he was young, he was married, he had 2 young children, he had a good job, but he had a problem. And for years, this has been a very severe problem in his life. He drank heavily. And because of that, there was a big dossier formed against him in his government office, and he was very worried over his future. He became a Baha'i that night, and I have never seen anything like it. The man transformed overnight. He became a new creation, practically overnight. He couldn't learn enough. He was always a very intelligent man, anyway, and an educated man. But he wanted and sick sometimes by the hours going to the groups. Had questions. He wanted to know more. We formed our local assembly that year with Enoch as one of the members. And then the misfortune befell him. He lost his job. It was really a very interesting thing because some of his the officers who were above him, they didn't know what to do. You know, it's the wheel of the bureaucracy. It had started months ago. And then when this young man had completely changed and everybody could see the change in him, they couldn't do anything about it because it had gone through the bureaucracy and now it took place. At this time, the third child was born in his family. And he was very frightened at how he's going to take care of his family. I never forget, he came the day that he had this news that he has lost his job. He came to our house and he came to see my father. He was very close. He was like a member of our family. He came to my father and he wept. He said, "What happened? Why this happened to me now?" It was a test, a great test for him. He has taken a step in a new phase, everything, and then this comes to him. And my father, in his simplicity that he was always, he had it, he looked at him, he said, "Enoch, don't worry. I assure you, something much better is awaiting you." And it didn't take more than 2 weeks when he got a much better job and everything was fine. He was earning good money, he had a good life, he was the member of the assembly, he had a holiday, a vacation, and he went to his hometown in the north of the country, in Teso. He went for 3 weeks and he came back. He came straight to our house. He came to my husband, to Ali, and he said, "Ali, you have to pack up and go to Teso." Ali said, "What has happened?" He said, "I have gone. I told all my relatives, all my friends. They all like this religion, but they don't believe me. They don't believe that I am telling you something, which is that you must go. And they have asked for you. They said, whoever told you this, he should come and tell us." And so Ali went to Teso. And when he came back, a month later, we had over 200 believers in that institute. These were really the first spiritual children of Enoch Olinga, which started from his own hometown, his own family, his own relatives, his own friends. By this time, Enoch was on the nice cloud. He was happy, everything was fine. And that summer, in October of 1952, the 10-year crusade began. The holy year began in the October of 1952, and Shoghi Effendi called upon the Baha'i world to conquer the virgin territories of this globe. It was a year of such excitement. I once asked my daughter, because she was very small, I once asked her, I said, "Tahir, do you remember those years?" "Oh," she said, "yes, I remember. You know what I remember? I remember the sound of the bicycle wheel on the gravel on the entrance to our house." I was surprised. I said, "How strange. Why do you remember that?" She said, "Because the bicycle man brought the telegrams of Shoghi Effendi." You see, my father was the hand of the cause in Africa. And from the moment this 10-year crusade began, all the cables, all the news from the Holy Land came to him, and then he would send it throughout the continent. So sometimes, maybe 5 times in a day, this bicycle fellow would come. And this is what she remembered, because the excitement, when we heard that sound, we knew another cable has come from Shoghi Effendi. In these cables, he was giving the news of the new territories open, new countries open to the face. It was one of the most exciting periods of my life ever. the happiness, the joy of these achievements of Shahriary was so tremendous. The following year, after the Rizwan of 53, it was around June of that year, when the local assemblies, the number of the believers in Uganda had arisen to a lot more than what it was. The local assemblies from 1 jumped into 13. Uganda was on the map. And what do you think Shoghi Effendi asked Uganda to do? This cable came encouraging the African believers to arise and go and conquer new territories in Africa. This was unheard of. You know, I am talking about an Africa which doesn't exist anymore. I'm talking of an Africa that there was such segregation, not only between the races, but between the tribes, between the countries. People did not travel as they do today. They were afraid of strangers. Three young men offered to go to pioneer from Uganda. And you can guess, one of them was Enoch Olinga. Another one was another young man who was a very wonderful. He came from a very distinguished Baganda family. The whole family were one of the upper class, very close. They were the tutors of the king of Uganda, of Baganda. They were very wonderful people. And this man was also a distinguished Baha'i. And then another young man. These three wanted to go. Now I have to take you a little bit back. Before I tell you how Enoch went on his pioneering, I have to tell you another tale, because they are all connected. In Rizwan of 1953, I had the bounty of going on pilgrimage. And it was a wonderful thing, unexpected, very wonderful, because Shoghi Effendi was so happy. He was so excited of all these goals that had been achieved, all the territories had opened, and so daily he would give the pilgrims the news of new developments. One day in the afternoon, when I was sitting with Amatul Baharu Yohano, as it was the custom, the women sat with her for tea, she suddenly turned to me. This she has done, I have seen it through this last 37 years of my life with her. She has done this to many people. She suddenly turned to me and she said, "Violette, why don't you go on a trip?" She said a little bit more personal things, but then she said, "Why don't you go on a trip on your own to Belgian Congo?" I said to myself, "What is she talking about? Belgian Congo? How can I go alone there?" She said, "By yourself. Don't go by anybody else. You go. You go and see Mr. and Mrs. Baghdad. These are isolated Baha'is there. Mrs. Baghdad is a Belgian woman. She became a Baha'i in the Holy Land. Go and see them, encourage them, and tell them that I remember how she became a Baha'i and how much we love her." I thought to myself, this was just kindness, sweetness, Ruhi Khan. She was trying to encourage me. Then we went that same afternoon in the presence of Shoghi Effendi. And lo and behold, if she didn't bring this subject up in front of her, this really shocked me. Because when she suddenly turned to Shoghi Effendi and said, "Shoghi Effendi, I have suggested to Violette to go on such a trip," my heart stopped. It's one thing for Ruhi Khanum to say, it's another when it goes in front of Shoghi Effendi. And he smiled, he looked at me, he said, "If it is possible, it would be very good. You do it." So I came home to Uganda with this news that I have to go to Belgian Congo. So we started making inquiries, how can I go to the Belgian Congo? Poor Ali tried everything. He had done everything until then. I had never taken a step without him. So somebody suggested that the only way to go is there are Greek truck drivers who come to Uganda, they buy produce, take it back, so I can take a lift from a green truck. We had a very good friend who was a baker, and he was a Greek. And I went and mentioned it to him. It's needless to say how surprised he was. And then he invited us one night to his home. He said, you know, two friends have come from Belgian Congo. They are truck drivers. You come and see them and talk with them and see what they can do for you. We went that night, and when they had, they were really typical truck drivers, huge men. And when Ali said what he wanted to do, they looked in amazement, and one of them, I never forget, he looked at Ali and said, you're crazy or something? And he said, no, it's my old there. We have friends there, and my wife wants to go to Kamina to see our friends. This man said, you know, Kamina is 1,400 miles from Uganda, from Kampala. How is she going to go? I am not going as far as Kamina. I can take her to such and such a town. I can give her to a friend of mine to take her to such and such a town. Eventually, she will reach Kamina. Then he said, but how can you send your young wife? I was young.
Society. The government was, it wasn't only
case they get into trouble with their government. So we arrive in the town, this little town of Kamina, with three young Africans in our car. We drive in front of the door of this poor Mr. and Mrs. Baghdad. The poor man almost had a heart attack. All the neighborhood, you see, everybody comes to see what are these people, these strangers, the cars, three Africans in the car. So this poor Baghdad immediately took us one side of the town where there was an African inn, and we put these men there, and we came back to discuss with him to see what help he can give. His wife went to bed with the most terrible headache. We didn't see her until the moment we were leaving the town the next day. They were really frightened. And I realized later on that they had every justification to be frightened. Because he could lose his job easily by sheltering a bunch of strangers, all of us strangers. So anyway, he agreed to have one of these young men, because one of them was for Belgian Congo. He agreed to find him a job in the town so that he could develop the community in this little town. So we left our Samson there, and then we went on. Eventually we reached the capital of Belgian Congo, which is called Kinshasa. It was a very European city, very expensive. To our disgust, we discovered that water was more expensive than petrol, that the wine was the cheapest thing you could drink. It was quite a terrible place. And there was one Baha'i in this town who was quite a character. She was a French woman. Her husband was a Belgian and worked for the government. She was a very fine artist. She did most beautiful. She took us to some of the buildings, government buildings, when she had painted some murals on the wall. She was quite well-known artist. But like some of the artists, she was a little bit eccentric. We stayed in the compound of these people for 3 weeks. Enoch and Max Kinyerezi stayed. They didn't have any servants in their house. So easily gave the rooms that usually is occupied by the servants, and no neighbor could question anything, to these two young men. Ali and I slept in our car, and they allowed us all to use their facilities. And we stayed there for 3 weeks because we wanted to make sure to get Max Kinyerezi to settle in what it was known at that time as French West Africa, which was one of the goals of the crusade. Today, French West Africa is divided into two, three countries. At that time, this whole huge place was one country. And eventually, through the friends that Madame Molitor had, she was able to get a residency for Max Kinyerezi. So we said goodbye to Belgian Congo, we crossed the river, and now we went to Brazzaville. We put Max, found for him a lodging, and now we don't want to leave. We went to the Automobile Association, the French Automobile Association. In those days it was called Michelin. So we went there to find out about the road from Congo, from Brazzaville to Cameroon. Nobody knew. They said, you know, on the map there are two roads. One of it, we know, it's not anymore usable, so it's closed. So it remains one road. The map only shows one section of this road, which takes you to a little island called Lambarine. Now, if any of you are doctors and familiar with the name of Lambarine, this is the island that Dr. Schweitzer opened her hospital facilities in, and he had so wonderful facilities because they said in those days it was known that this particular area in Africa was really like a graveyard of Africa. It was the place where the all kinds of random malaria was prevalent. It was a place of very, very bad dysentery, and also the tsetse disease fly, which gives you the sleeping illness. So this is why Dr. Lambarine had opened this hospital to help people in this area. He was a very wonderful man. And what he did for Africa and for the research into all of these diseases is never going to be forgotten. So we said, all right, we will go to Lambarine, we will find more about the rest of the road. And I don't tell you what the road was telling. We reached Lambarine. You have to go on a ferry to get on the island. This little island had a group of French government officials who were all in the hotel. We were driving a French car. It excited them so much that a French car is crossing the continent of Africa. They didn't care a hoot for us, but it's a French car. So we arrived there, we spent 2 or 3 days in Lambarine trying to find out more about where we were going, how we were going to cross. They told us that there is this river, and the only way to go through is to put the car on a ferry and go a distance of 100 kilometers on this river. I cannot tell you, this is really unbelievable. It was hot because this, you know, Africa has this fabulous forest jungle from the east, which went from the east to the west of the continent, called the Ituri Forest. Many parts of it now is completely gone and they built up. But in the areas where this forest exists, they are quite atrocious. This particular area we went to, you could not see the sky. You drove on the river, but you wouldn't see the sky for miles because of the thickness of trees. These are virgin jungles, a wonderful things to see if you have good facilities. Anyway, we traveled, we started on this river sometime around 11 in the morning when the ferry started, and it reached the end of its route by 11 at night. It was dark, it was hot, and they told us that we have to stay on the ferry until morning. When it's morning, they'll help us to get on the road. When the first ray of the sun came and we looked, all that we could see was like a wall next to the river. Above it was a village. There was no road to go up. It was just a cliff. We looked at this cliff, we said, how can we get up there? Oh, there were a lot, hundreds of men around, and they all laughed, and they all joked, and they all came and said, oh, don't worry, we will put you up on the road. And they practically pushed this car up this cliff. And when we reached on the top, the ferry turned around and went. And there we were, in a village. We asked, where is the district officer here? They pointed to a house. I shall never forget, it was 7 o'clock in the morning when we knocked at the door of this Frenchman who was still in his pajamas. He opened the door, he looked at Ali and I, and he said, who are you? Where are you coming from? He said, we just came from Lambarine. So where are you going? He said, we are going to Cameroon. And he just put his hands on his head and said, mon Dieu, oh God, you know, crazy people. I think he felt so sorry for us. He invited us in, he gave us a good breakfast. I think this is where he thought it was his last acts for this crazy couple. He gave us a gallon of petrol. And he said, go. We said, how is the road? He said, I don't know. There's no road, but you go. He told us that there is 200 kilometers, that there is no road. and it goes through this jungle. And the road is only for very big trucks. But now in this car you try, see what happens. And Ali, who is a born optimist, he said, 200 kilometers is nothing. We can do it. We can do it all in one day. So we started. It took us, we left at 8 o'clock that morning. We reached the halfway, which he had told us. When Ali said we can do it in one day, he said no. But if you can do half of it and reach to this little hut, you can spend the night there and then do the rest tomorrow. We started at 8 in the morning and we reached this hut at 11 that night. You can imagine what the road was. It was a road that continuously, either we fell in ditches or the, you see these roads was for the trucks, so there was a big hump in the middle and two gutters in the sides. So what we would, our only, Ali was our, the only driver. Neither Enoch nor I could drive. He was the only one who could speak French. Neither Enoch or I could speak it. So he was the poor man, was everything. So we started, and he would fall in the ditch. He would fall in a, get, you know, stranded on the top of this hump. And he just go like this and wouldn't move. Now we have come from a settlement, maybe a village, maybe about 2 hours before, which didn't mean much. Maybe it's about 5-10 miles. And so Ali would say, we can't do it ourselves. He had to walk back to that village to find men, to ask them, please come and help us. They'd come and take us out of the ditch. We would go, we would fall again. So it took us from 8 in the morning to 11 that night to reach this little hut. We were exhausted. But we thought, well, the worst is over, you know, we have, this, nothing can be worse than this. So that night, we slept in the car, Enoch slept in the hut, and in the morning, we said we'll start very early. 5 in the morning, we were in the car, we said this time we'll start early to get through the next 100 kilometers. We hadn't gone more than half an hour when we came across this huge tree fallen and blocked this tiny little road. And 4 little men from some village with a tiny axes in their hands, they were trying to break the Enoch and Ali both joined the labor force. They worked for 6 solid hours until they were able to move enough of this trunk for us to go through. By then, morning had finished. It was afternoon. And the problem with the car was the same, and the road was as bad. And we had just gone down, and this jungle is quite something. It's one of the mightiest rivers in Africa, goes through this. So one side of the road was, you couldn't see anything. It was a thick block of trees and bushes. And the other side was river, this very, very fierce river going through. And every now and then, every few miles, you would come to a tree with a big sign on it in French, with the head of an elephant or a gorilla. And on it, it says, these are the only areas where you can hunt. So it was true. This was really the only place in the whole of the continent of Africa where it had hunting season, and hunters came for hunting either gorillas or elephants. We never saw either of them. We heard a lot of their noise, but we did not see them. So we had gone down the hill, the car fell in a ditch, and we couldn't do anything. It was 5 in the afternoon. So Ali said, we far is the village behind us? It's too far. We can't do anything. So we must be near something. We will leave the car here. We will walk for 20 minutes, half an hour. If we didn't come to a village, we will walk back the half an hour before it is dark, and we'll spend the night in the car, and tomorrow we'll see what we do. We walked about 20 minutes when we came to a settlement. Now these were not villages. These were little settlements that the French government had really established for the maintenance of this road. And the people who lived there, they were forced laborers. That's all they were. They had forced these people to come and live in these huts to maintain the road. Nobody could maintain that road anyway. So we arrived in this village, and Ali went, and there were about 10 huts. And Ali went and knocked at the door, and he called the headman, and he told him the story, that what has happened to us. The headman called all their men, and all the men went back to the car to see if they can lift it from the ditch. Something happened to me in that village that I am so grateful to Baha'u'llah for it, because I really consider it my own reawakening. I was exhausted. I was not feeling well. I was hungry. I was frightened. I had left my little girl. I put her on a plane and sent her to Nairobi to the family of the Yazidis to take care of her. I was frightened that I will never see her again. What will happen here? And there we are in this jungle amongst a group of strange people. They went and I stayed alone, and there was an old woman in this village. She was a little woman. She was so old that she had just a little kind of a pompon of white hair on the top of her head. She was wrinkled from top to bottom. She was naked, and she was all painted. You know, even in 1969, when I went on that trip with Rabbi Yochanan, we never saw these people again. These are finished. This woman was the grandmother in the area. She came to me, and she saw how she brought, as soon as men went, she brought a little stool and put it down, and she pushed me down with this. I sat down and I looked at her, and I looked at the people around me, and I felt it's the end, and I wasn't a bit frightened of dying. In fact, I thought what a wonderful thing to die and finish with it all. And I thought, well, these people, these savages here, what are they going to do with us? I didn't even think. I think I was too numb. This woman called two younger women. She brought them in front of me, and she was trying, there was no doubt in my mind, she was trying to cheer me up. She took these, brought these two young women, and she pointed to her stomach, and she pointed to them. And she was, I felt she was telling me they were her daughters or her children, you know, something. And then she shoot them off, and they both rushed towards the river. In a little while, they came back with a basin of water from the river. The old woman put the basin in front of me. She took my shoes off. She put my feet on this water. And she told the two girls to sit down and rub my feet. I was completely numb. I just looked as if it's happening to somebody else, not to me. And they start massaging my feet, and giggling, and saying things, and laughing, and every now and then they would tap my legs, you know, to say, don't be afraid. I think that's what they said. And then my eyes followed the old woman. She went to these huts, and she knocked at doors. Every time the door opened, the woman came to the door. She had her hands like this, and they put something in her hands. And then she came to me, and her palms had a handful of tiny little peanuts and one banana, which was black, a small banana. She brought this, and she stood in front of me. And I burst into tears, and I became hysterical. I thought to myself, oh, Baha'u'llah, what was I thinking? Where would I get this humanity, this kindness, this love, from a woman that I thought was a savage? She doesn't know me. I am different from her. And as I cried, she became really, she went crazy. She started running around me. She patted my head. She peeled the banana. She forced it in my mouth. And she did everything. You know, she didn't want me, I know she wanted me to stop to cry, and I couldn't stop crying. I was emotionally completely drained. This love that I saw from this old woman, I have never seen like it, ever. That night they gave us an unfinished hut, because when the men came back, they came without the car. Ali said, it's not the ditch, there's something wrong with the car. And they had carried, all the men carried our beddings, and they came. These people gave us an unfinished hut. And they said, now you sleep and we will see tomorrow what we will do. Ali said, I have tried everything. He wasn't a mechanic. He didn't know what to do with the car. He didn't know what was the trouble with the car. It was a brand new car. My poor father had just bought it when we started the trip. So that night we realized that our food also was finished, because we had worked out that by the time we are out of this area, we are in a big town, and we can replenish our food. I made that night, we had a little stove, so I made a nice porridge, and we had some canned meat, and we ate our dinner. We had prayers, we consulted what to do. We decided it was Enoch's decision, it was his own idea. Said, look, Ali, you cannot go, because Violet cannot go. The car is not running. I am the only one who can walk, because the headman of the village told us that the only way was that we go. We had 50 kilometers to get to this town. He said the only way is to go by foot. So Enoch said, okay, I'll go. I'll go tomorrow. I will hire a guide from here, and I walk, and I get help to come back and bring you out of your miseries. So we spoke with the headman. We hired a guide from this village to walk with Enoch the next morning. And we had our prayers, and Ali sat down, and laboriously, because Enoch couldn't speak a word of French, he didn't know the language of the people, so Ali wrote 6 pages in French of the story of who we are, where we are, what has happened, who this young man is, and please come and rescue us. So the next morning at 5 a.m, Enoch set up, and I did something which was the silliest thing. I wouldn't do it again, but I did it then, because I felt terrible that Enoch was going. And he gave him a lot of cash, because he needed to hire more guards, and all in front of everybody. And then I gave him our last can of milk, and we sent him off. Because I told Ali, I said, look, let him have it, because we don't know where he is going. We can buy some, if nothing, we can buy some bananas from these people and eat. Enoch went at 5 a.m, and Ali got up and went down the hill to his car to see if he can work it. And all the men went with him. single bolt or anything electrical on me to see what was wrong. They had told us that we should hurry out of this area because it's the beginning of the rainy season. And he was really working hard because you could hear the grumbling. And it was 1 p.m. when he accidentally touched something under the car. And I was all the time turning the switch on to see if it worked, and it suddenly stopped. The engine stopped. We went crazy. We put everything in the car because our thoughts were constantly with Enoch. What we were frightened for him. We said, look, he's a stranger, a strange African amongst these people. Nobody knows him. They can't talk to him. He has this, so he has a lot of cash in his pocket. If the man, the guy, just pull a knife and kill him and throw him in that river, nobody will ever know. And supposing they know, supposing we go and say something, who cares? Nobody's going to search for him. For them, he was another African. Nobody's going to know. We were really beside ourselves with worry for Enoch. He had left a wife and 3 children. We had promised the beloved guardian that we would get him to his pioneering post, and now we imagined all kinds of tragedies. 1 o'clock, the car started, we put everything in the car, and in our eagerness to catch up with Enoch, we didn't think to take a guide with us. So this time it's just the two of us. We started. And the moment we started, the rain came down. And what a rain. If you've seen any of the Tarzan films, believe me, the rain is quite true. We started this 15 kilometers to get to the next village. It took us from 1 p.m. till 9 o'clock that night to reach this 15 kilometers. And these 15 kilometers were the most unbelievable part of this trip. We fell in ditches, the car would stop, and it would go under it. And because of the rain, the swarms of tsetse flies, which are most horrible things, they are quite big flies, and they inject you like a real injection. Poor Ali got wet, he got muddy, he took everything off except his underpants, and he was bitten by these flies. There wasn't a spot. He became so swollen that when we came out, he couldn't wear anything anymore. And every time, you know, and I would go to bring, there was no stones in here to put under the wheels to get out of the mud. The only thing you could get, I would go in the side of the road, and they were all the dead vegetation under the trees. And I put my arms and bring an armful, and I remember so many times, one time particularly, when these 2 red eyes from deep down looked at me. I don't know what they were, I just closed my eyes. And all these dry leaves and dry grass, to put it in the mud to get the wheels a little bit lifted. This happened over and over and over. And that was the only time we saw the tail of the last elephant running from the river into the interior. You know, every time we were stuck, we would hear this rumbling. The whole, we felt as if the whole jungle was just going like this. We thought it was the lightning, you know, and the rain, until we came across the last tail going in. It were the herds of elephants coming up from the river, going into the interior. Every time we were stuck, ahead of us, a herd has passed. And we were really saved miraculously. Because had they come, had the herd come when the car was passing, nothing would have been left of the car or us. They would have just flattened everything and gone in. At one point, when it was, I think, the umpteen times, and it had already got dark, and I had a flashlight in my hand, and Ali was under the car. As before he went under the car got stuck, and he came out. He was exhausted. And then Ali gave up. It was the first and the last time I have seen that husband of mine who really lost his optimism. He fell on his knees and he put his forehead on that mud and he said, Baha'u'llah, it is yours, in your hand. I cannot do it anymore. From now I give it to you. You take over. And it was on, and he wept and I wept. And do you know, that was the last time he got stuck. I think it was his test. He always thought, oh, here we go. Everything will be all right. Things are fine. Until he reached the point that he gave up his own will completely to our last will. He reached this village. The first thing they asked was, did you see this stranger who came past by here? Oh yes, they've seen it. We saw the guide. He has changed another with another guide. Oh yes, they say he was here at lunch. He ate lunch. We gave him a guide and he's gone. He couldn't do anything. He slept that night in that village. And the next morning we started slowly, slowly, slowly. And every time we came to a village, we asked, they had seen Enoch and they always told us, oh, such and such hour we just passed. Until we came to a river, this famous river. And here we had to cross the river. And I don't know if you have ever seen those bridges that they used to make. It looked like very heavy ropes, but it's not even ropes. On the tree. And to think of a car to drive over that bridge. But we reached the bank of this river and we looked the other side and we saw Enoch Olinga. He stood like a zombie and we like a pair of zombies. We looked at each other. We couldn't believe our eyes. Because by then we were sure he's no more alive. We passed this river, we reached, and the three of us just hung in each other's neck, and we wept, and we thanked God that we were safe. We passed danger. We reached this little town, and they put these two men in hospital, both of them. Enoch had the most terrible dysentery and malaria, and Ali, they put him for observation for 132 bites of these tsetse flies. They wouldn't let him go until they were sure he was not infected. And Enoch told us that afternoon of something which changed his life. We, as well as Enoch, we thought that this was his real rebirth. He told us that the night that he was alone and he reached this village and he had very high fever, he was quite sick, quite frightened, exhausted to the bone. He said, I fell on the floor to sleep and I wept, he said. And I said to myself, you fool, what got into you? What are you doing here? Why did you leave your home, your family, your security, your wife and children? What for? How do you know this is the truth? How do you know what the decision you have taken is good? He was completely broken and frightened and shaken. And he fell asleep. And he had a dream that night. He dreamt that he was lying in the mud. And Shoghi Effendi came to him and called him and lifted him up. And with all the mud on him, he took him in his arms and kissed both his cheeks. And he said, "Enoch, I am well pleased with you." Enoch woke up. And he said, "I woke up and I went on my knees and I said, 'My beloved Shoghi Effendi, I will do this for you the rest of my life. I am ready to do it every day of my life.'" Yeah. This was really the rebirth of Enoch Olinga. And from then on, he really earned the wonderful title that Shoghi Effendi gave him, the Father of Victories.
Yes. Yes.
So we came out of this whole thing. That was another one. We went to this French district officer. And when he saw us and he asked us where we came from and he heard where we came from, he couldn't believe it. He invited us in. He asked Ali what happened, and Ali was so exhausted. He took this letter that he had written and he said, "You know what? I can't tell you, it's all in there. You read it." This man sat down and read this whole event. He told us something very interesting. He said, "I don't know who you are. I don't know where you come from. But I know that this has been a miracle. That there has been a hand over you, I don't know whose hand." Then he told us, he said, "I am the district officer here. And 3 weeks before, I had gone on a tour of inspection. He said, I reached this village that housed you that night, your troubles. He said, I flogged the head man in public." Now, if you know the Africans and the dignity and the pride of anybody, not African, any people, to have flogged the head man in the public in front of all the women folk and all the villagers, he said, "I flogged him because he had not maintained the road. But," he said, "I did it because I know I am leaving this country. I will never dare to put my foot in any of these villages on this road." He said, "I know, if they find me, they kill me, and they have every justification." And he said, "How come? 3 weeks after I have done this to these people, you two white people go in their village, and they treat you as a guest, an honored guest, and take care of you?" He said, "I can't believe it. Must be, you must have a savior above you." How little he knew what savior we had. We left, and now we are out of hospital, we are well, and the date is getting near the end of the holy year, and we want to get Enoch Olinga to his post before the end of the holy year, the 15th of October. We rushed through, we got the car fixed, we discovered that when it came up that cliff, something went wrong with the clutch disc, and so this was fixed, and we went through, and eventually we reached Cameroon, and we crossed the border, and we got to this little town of Manfi, which had a post office, on the 15th of October, 1953. The postmaster was locking the door of the post office because it was 4 o'clock. Ali stopped the car, rushed to this poor man, held his hand, he said, "You cannot close, you cannot, you must send the cable." And he was so taken by such surprise, he opened quickly the door of the post office. They went in and Enoch wrote his cable to the beloved guardian, telling him that he has arrived in his post. Now we have to pay for the telegraph, and we realize we have no money. We have entered a new country and we have no money. So Ali told this man, he said, "Can I pay you?" He said, traveler's check? He didn't know what traveler's check. He said, no, I can't take it. Then he pointed, he said, across the road is an Englishman, a civil servant there. You go, maybe he can help. So Ali went to this house, and it was a very nice young man, and he opened the door, and he agreed to change enough money for Ali to pay the telegram, and Enoch Olinga had reached his goal. Now we have to go to the capital, which is Victoria. We spend the night in Manfe, and the next day we arrive in Victoria. Now we were so sure that all we had to do was to go and see the governor and say, or the district officer or whoever was there, and tell them that this is now how to tell them. We had to make stories. Mm-hmm. We cannot tell this English officer in his colonial post that we have brought the Baha'i pioneer from Uganda to put in your country. We had to have some excuse. We said, well, we are tourists, you know. We are crossing the continent. We have come here. And there was this young man, we knew him, he's a very nice young man, and he has been a good friend. So he wanted to come and see Cameroon, so we gave him a lift, we have brought him here, which was a really very unbelievable story. They accepted. Well, he stayed 1 week. We noticed that this tiny little town, with maybe 10 English families there, who were civil servants, everybody was looking at us. We are in this government guest house. What are you doing here? All right, you've come, you're tourists. What is it to see in this town of Victoria? Walk on the beach. So one day, and Ali had to keep away, because if they felt that we were anxious for Enoch to get his residency, it would turn against him. So we had to keep far. We had our meeting place was at when it was dark, we would go to the beach, and then he would come and tell us what happened that day, and we would tell him what happened to us. One day I was all alone, and I went, I found that there was a little library, the municipal library. So I went into this library to see if I can see something, amuse myself. And I saw a young man, African young man, who was lame in one leg. But he had the most beautiful face, a smile that just captured my heart. I said hello to him, and he said, hello. And he said, you're a stranger here? No local man would say hello. So I said, yes, I'm a stranger. He said, what you doing here? I said, well, we are tourists, but we brought a friend of ours from Uganda. And this young man is looking for a place to rent, to live. Do you know anywhere? And he said, well, he can come and live with my wife and I now until he finds a place. So I was so glad, because Enoch was in an inn, you know, African hotel, which was not clean, which was not good. He didn't want to stay there, and it was expensive for him. So the next day, I brought Enoch to the library, introduced him to this young man, and immediately this young man took him home. His name was David Tanny. Mm-hmm. David Tanny became the first Baha'i in Cameroon. He became the close friend of Enoch Olinga. A year later, when Shoghi Effendi asked the Baha'is of Cameroon to go to the neighboring countries and open up these virgin territories, and five young men from Cameroon volunteered to go. One of them was this David Tanny, which to this day is living in Ghana. And maybe some of you have seen his son, who's called Enoch. His son has written a very wonderful book, Introduction of the Baha'i Faith. And they are a distinguished family. All the children are very distinguished Baha'is. Anyway, after 1 week, we consulted, we decided that it was not safe for us to stay with him. Am I talking too much?
And
sat down to drink our little cup of hot cocoa with a piece of bread. When these lasted, Greeks started making kebab. Following year, he was able to send 5 Knights of Baha'u'llah out into the neighboring countries. And then I will finish the story of Enoch only with when the news came that he was the hand of the cross. Because that is it was in 1957. He was visiting Uganda at that time when the cable of the beloved guardian came to my father to inform 3 men in Africa that they have been elevated to the rank of the hands of the cross: William Sears, John Robarts, and Enoch Olinga. To those 2, my father sent a cable because they were in South Africa. For Enoch Olinga, he said, I want to tell him myself. So we phoned Enoch. He was staying in Hazratabad. He came to our house, and my father gave him the cable of Shoghi Effendi. I will never forget his reaction. I had seen what he did. I had seen it only once in Africa. When we had just arrived in Uganda, they had invited us to go. There was an annual audience day of the king when all his chiefs come from all over and they report to him. And it was very interesting for us. We were newcomers. We were visiting. And as every chief approached the throne of his king, when he got halfway near, he would prostrate himself fully on the floor and put his head down. When Enoch Olinga read the cable of Shoghi Effendi, this was spontaneous in him. He fell on the ground, he opened his arms, and he put his forehead on the ground, and he wept. He was in the presence of his king, his beloved.
Before we have a closing prayer, I have some very good news to share. I have just been informed by another member of the Spiritual Assembly that 10 of the Baha'is that were arrested have been released. So now I'd like to have the closing prayer. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for coming. Sorry about the buzz,
she ran. Thank you.